What's going on, my soul family? On today's episode, I have brought on a very special guest, my fiance, Melissa Scambolori. And on today's episode, we're going to be dropping in and talking about how we went from breaking up to engagement. Mm. And this has to be one of the most requested things
for sure
for us to talk about, which, you know, we haven't really talked much about it. And I think a lot of people are kind of questioning their relationships because maybe they're going through a breakup or they're with somebody they're not really sure about. So the focus of this episode is to help you have more clarity in your relationships about what you really desire. Because just because you broke up doesn't mean that you're meant to get back together and you need to force this relationship to work. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of times when people break up, it's probably for the better.
Right.
You know, a lot of my previous relationships, when we broke up, we were meant to break up. And when we got back together, it just never really seemed right.
But I think that that's what most people don't see is how many times it didn't work, right. You know, and how many times each one of us have walked away from a relationship completely. So it's not just about, well, Melissa and Jake got back together. So like, I'm meant to get back together with my ex, you know, it depends on the foundation of the relationship.
Yeah. And I think that it's not easy. You know, it's difficult when you go through that pain, when you experience that. You know, for me, the way that I was showing up in the relationship, our relationship, it was, I had a deep fear of commitment. And I've talked about this before. And I think a lot of masculine people really struggle with the idea of commitment, you know, because we have this fear around, well, if I commit deeper and I'm not half in, half out, wishy-washy, like I've been in most of my relationships and pretty much my whole life until I learned the art of commitment, I thought it was going to compromise my personal freedom. And it was almost like that FOMO, right? That fear of missing out on something else. So because of my programming, it wasn't allowing me to fully step in to the container of our relationship, which in parallel to that wasn't allowing you to feel safe because I wasn't all the way in. Mm-hmm. And it's so interesting because commitment to me, and once again, people have different ideas of commitment, but commitment to me is basically allowing yourself to step fully into a relationship, to create a safer environment, to go deeper with that person. And I look at relationships kind of like a well. You can have relationships that are very shallow and surface level and keep everything casual, which oftentimes is a response of our own pain to keep people at bay from us, which is what I experienced in my life. But if you go deeper, you get to that richer, more healing, purified water. Mm-hmm. And it's not easy. Like, relationships bring challenges. They bring out our deepest shadows. So if you're willing to go deeper into that relationship, if you feel aligned with someone, you're going to have to work through your own fears and your own shadows.
Yeah, I agree. That's where being vulnerable and open is going to be key.
Yeah.
Because if someone doesn't know what you're struggling with, then how can they support you? And it really is such a big thing to focus on.
So when we first broke up, let's talk about that. Because I know people are just waiting to hear.
Yuck.
Waiting to hear the juicy, like, all right, let's get on with it. What really happened
here?
What's
going on?
When we first broke up, what would you feel and what did you feel like was happening in our relationship?
I felt as though, well, it's hard because going through that gave me clarity about myself. So initially, I kept feeling as though, and I know I share this with you, is energetically, I felt like your hand was up and I could only get in so far. It was like not both hands, but one hand was up. Remember, I used to say that to you. I'm like, I just feel like the best way I can describe it is like there's like one hand and you're like holding me back so I can't get in. But when we took time apart, I started to realize that the things that you had been expressing, because my ego didn't want to look at myself as the problem. I wanted to be like, well, he just can't do it. But I started to realize that I wasn't even allowing you to try because I call them like my energetic dukes were like kind of up. Because remember, you used to say to me a lot, please stop fighting me on this. Like, why do you have to like come back with like, yeah, but, you know, and it was, and it was my way I had been for quite some time of like developing like an over independence that like, I didn't realize that what I was doing was kind of pushing you away. So you could feel that as well. But taking that time apart, I'm like, I really am not even if we got back together or not, not even that, but just realizing, you know what? I think I'm being like guarded too. And I thought I was like open, you know, and maybe if I can judge in this moment, I was a little more open than you were, but I definitely wasn't fully open.
So yeah, what I felt too, I definitely felt your masculine shield is what I would call it.
And you came
into this relationship, like, you know, you had been single for a few years and you were really focused on your independence, but it was almost like you had overdeveloped your masculine to a certain point where you were in competition with my inner masculine. And that was really frustrating to me because we were constantly butting heads in our sense of who's the more masculine power here. Yeah. Right. And we were in competition with each other's masculine energy. So if you're in a relationship right now for the listener and you find yourself being in competition with each other's masculine energy, and you're constantly challenging each other in a very masculine way, that's like the fastest way to depolarize your relationship.
Mm-hmm. And honestly, I didn't want that.
Yeah.
That's not what I wanted, but that's what I was doing. Does that mean, you know what I mean?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't think any feminine person wants to be challenging their masculine partner, but if they don't feel safe in the relationship, or they're carrying a masculine shield from previous masculine pain, which a lot of times is the case. Mm-hmm. They come into that relationship a little bit guarded because they've been hurt in the past. So they put up this masculine wall around their heart and they're not fully open in the relationship. So I also wasn't super grounded in my masculinity. And I think that's something that I've grown into as I've stepped more into this union and this container with you. And you've helped me a lot with that. So it's like you coming more into your feminine, me coming more into my masculine, balanced itself out. But there was a point when we were full on clashing. And I remember sitting down with you and saying, I just don't feel aligned with you right now.
I know. Like, and your energy is just
pissing me off. You know, like, yes. I was just like, I felt like I was in competition with you all the time. And our polarity was so just clashing.
Yeah. But again, if you didn't tell me that, you know, right. it comes to, I think a lot of people just like bottle up and just like kind of go with something that doesn't feel right. And they're like, well, this is fine. But like, if you didn't tell me that, then this reflection, like our relationship either would have totally just like broken apart, or we never would have been able to come back together without the honesty.
Yeah.
It's, even if it hurts, it's lovingly being honest with your partner. Cause I didn't like to hear that. Like, what? Like, what am I doing? But it was a collection of both of us.
Yeah.
Just, it starts out like most relationships. You don't really take things as serious in the beginning because it's like really fun and you're really focused on the things that are great. And you kind of let some things like fall by the wayside. And then once you start intertwining your lives, then you see how people show up and how they deal with conflict or stress, or, you know, and that's the time when the work starts, and you'll quickly see whether two people are willing to do the work or if one's just kind of tugging the other one down the road. And that's exhausting and really hard to create a successful container.
Yeah. I think, you know, what I hear a lot in relationships is I feel so open, but my partner is just not.
Yeah.
And relationships in life bring enough challenge as it is. So to be in a relationship with somebody who's not willing to work on themselves, who's not willing to change, is so hard. And it's not going to create a lot of safety in that relationship with a person who's just emotionally numb. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what I experienced with Melissa, and she can obviously speak to what she experienced with me, we're very open. We speak freely in our relationship. And we've also learned not to judge each other, which has been a huge learning curve for both of us. Mm-hmm. Is because judgment doesn't create safety in a relationship. But I think what I was experiencing was, it was almost like you didn't feel safe and you were threatened by my masculinity. And I think a lot of that had to do with your previous experience of masculinity. And once again, I wasn't super grounded in my masculinity. I needed to still come further into that. And I wasn't being fully devoted to this relationship. And I could feel that. But I also had that resistance within myself. So it was like you were, in a sense, threatened by that, and then, which was the manifestation of the competition between our masculine energies. And it just wasn't creating a lot of safety. It wasn't creating a lot of polarity between us. So that's really the point where we went through a breakup. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I basically said, I left it up to the universe and God. I was just like, listen, if this woman is meant to be in my life, like, put her in my life, but also help me here.
Yeah.
Because I need to know how to move forward with this relationship, because I know I love her. And it's like, how do I be with her?
I think that's always been kind of like the underlining thing, or like the fact is like it wasn't that we were like, I'm over him, I'm over her. Like, it wasn't really that. It wasn't that we were questioning our feelings for one another. It was just, can we figure this out in a way that's going to be healing and good for both of us? Right. And you're correct. And it's like in saying, like, from previous relationships, is that I left a toxic relationship, you know, and that was really hard for me. So once I fully kind of let that go, I felt powerful, but then I developed like an oversense of power, like, you can't get in now, you know, like, and I realized that now, again, I wasn't really fully looking at me, because it's easier to look outward when things are going on and we all have our own struggles, our own things to work through. But I think that I overdeveloped that false sense of power to the point where, like, if I didn't allow myself to open as you were being more grounded, then it wouldn't have worked either. Like, it's a two-way street for sure.
You know, I think what I was craving from you was softness. Mm-hmm. And I think what you were craving from me, if I could speak for you in this moment, is just really like my grounded strength. And I think that that was lacking in the relationship. And one of the things that the masculine yearns for the most from the feminine is softness, is that soft, open receptivity. And I think because there was a sense of you were a little guarded there, mm-hmm. you were putting up this shield towards me, I wasn't really able to get in fully to your deep heart, which is what I really wanted. You know, I really wanted to go deep with you. But it's so interesting, because as we progressed in our relationship, I did feel you start to open, but I also start to feel myself become more clear. And I noticed that the more clear that I was with my direction, and how confident I was, and how certain I was, and how committed, that's another thing, I was to this relationship, the more your flower opened to me. And I think a lot of women aren't fully open to their man because he's a little distracted. Maybe he's a little flighty. Maybe he's a little inconsistent. Maybe he's not really clear on his direction in life. And those things are fine, right? But the key for the masculine is to be aiming for that 80% mark. Mm-hmm. You know, in the world of nutrition, I often say, if you can eat healthy 80% of the time, mm-hmm. then that's pretty good. Yeah. If you can go to the gym 80% of the time, you know, if you can hit those marks, not try to be 100% perfect, but in the masculine dynamic, if you can strive for 80% of the time to have clarity, to have confidence, to have direction, mm-hmm. to be decisive, to lead, mm-hmm. the better you get at that, the more receptive your woman, your feminine, the woman in your life, if she's feminine, will be open to you. And that, once again, I have to be very clear about how I say this, because just because you are clear with your direction and you're, you know, you're confident, you're grounded, that doesn't guarantee her openness. That doesn't guarantee her receptivity, right? She still has her work to do. And I think that's where, you know, you stepped in really to open.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just keep seeing like a two-way street. Yeah. It really is. It's like you can be the best version of yourself and be grounded in truth and all that and love, and that's kind of how you know, I feel, if the relationship is going to work or not, because you can say, look, I did the best that I could. And so you can walk away from the relationship because that person is either going to allow you in or they're not. But as long as you're doing, you know, you're showing up to your fullest capabilities and you're being honest, and that's all you really can do. It's we always say it, right? It's not a guarantee. It's just an invitation. So they have to accept that invitation. But let me tell you, for me now, having so much clarity around the type of relationship I want and the container for us is like, when you, like, you don't have to have it all lined up and figured out, but the most attractive thing about masculinity, or one of the most attractive things, is just being like motivated to bring something into the world. Like, I don't have it all lined up, and but I know that this is something I want to do, or I know that I want to make a change in the world. Like, whatever it is, whatever you want to bring into the world, you don't have to have all your ducks in a row, so to say, or so to speak. It's just more about the motivation behind it. It is so sexy to me. I think I feel like confident enough that I could speak for many women, like feminine women listening, is like, it is, it's just a really beautiful thing, because I have learned, especially from being in this relationship, is if you don't have clarity or you don't feel good about what you're doing outside of the relationship, it shows in the container.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, if I'm the only focal point, it puts too much pressure on me. And because I think we want something, but then we get it. We're like, oh gosh, this is too much. You know, you have to add to each other's lives.
Well, yeah. The other day I was having a conversation with a friend of mine, and I asked him, I said, what is your plans? What's your vision for the next 12 months?
Mm-hmm.
And he really was very unclear, and I could see the frustration in him. And so then he resorted to his relationship
because
he wasn't really clear with his mission. So he's like, well, you know, I'm planning on moving in with my woman and getting married.
Yeah.
And I said, that's cool, but what's your mission? What are your goals? And because for the masculine, specifically speaking, we feel best when we feel accomplished, when we feel productive, when we feel like our mission is having a meaningful impact. And when we don't have that clear direction, we often feel like an inner resistance happening. So, you know, for the masculine people listening right now, it's so important that you have a focal point that you're moving towards. Because if you make your relationship the single focus of your life, mm-hmm. your woman's going to be like, what happened to your drive?
Mm-hmm.
What happened to your ambition? The feminine is super attracted to a man with a purpose, to a man with a mission. And I've heard that time and time again, like, I love a man that has a purpose. I love a man that has a mission.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't want to be the center focus of your entire life.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds good in like poems and stuff, but I'm telling you right now, eventually she's going to be like, okay, get your shit together. Go find something else to do other than, you know, be looking at me all day long.
Yeah. Like, it sounds great.
Yeah.
I don't really know how to like express that feeling.
Yes,
because
you do.
No, but I mean,
you don't want him to be up your ass all day long.
No.
And there's nothing wrong with expressing that too. And
I want you to be clear about the way you feel about me, as clear as you can be. I want you to be, make me a priority. And it's not like work consistently has to be number one. Like, sometimes things shift around and be like, okay, you know,
they complement each other.
So it's
his
not
mission
to say,
and his relationship complement.
Because I
other.
Do hear a lot of women say, you know, my man or my husband or my masculine is spending so much time working, and like, I feel
that's imbalanced.
Like, so that's what I mean, is it's not that it's like, oh well, he's focused on his mission, like I'll just sit here and wait for him to make time for me. It really is making it a priority. Like, if I can share and be you share something that I noticed that made me tear up. It was probably a while ago, but I came in your office to move some things around, and I was cleaning the floor, and I saw your to-do list of like different things. And I noticed on there, it was like all neat and separated, but one of the things on the list was love Melissa. And I smiled for a second because I'm like, oh my gosh. But honestly, the world and
we're supposed to see that.
But the world and the things going on in it can really get very distracting.
Yeah.
And I thought it was so cute and amazing that just in case you were up, you know, in your office doing things for too long, just the reminder to be like, have I made time for my woman today? I think it just made me like all like sorts of giddy and cute. And I'm like, I love that.
She's really sharing my insider stuff right now.
Mm-hmm. But I feel like it's
put me on blast.
But I feel like it's important because it's not like you would forget. It's just a matter of giving yourself
you
reminders.
Can forget.
Yeah.
You definitely can forget. Because that's the thing is the masculine's very single focused, right? So we see the goal, we see the mission, and we lose sight of everything else in that.
Yeah.
So that's why it's important to remind ourselves, like, hey, you got a woman in your life. Hey, you got a family. Mm-hmm. Hey, you got friends. Reach out.
And that's healing.
Yeah.
That's necessary.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Because honestly, too, like what I have found is like in my deep states of isolation was like I've cut myself off at certain points in my healing journey just from everything. Okay. And, you know, maybe I needed to do that, but like I was very almost like sense of depressed. Mm-hmm. And now I've integrated back with all of that, right? I brought back in some really good masculine men in my life and friends and relationships and even rekindled, you know, family member relationships, stuff like that. But to me, relationships are so valuable. And I think that the masculine people, they do want love, right? But the thing is, they become so focused on the mission where they forget to take care of that love. So eventually the love starts to dwindle. Mm-hmm. And she's like saying, how come he doesn't see me anymore?
Right.
I was having this conversation with a buddy of mine the other day who's very masculine. And I said, why don't you stop and get your girl some flowers today? Why don't you just do that? Walk in the door, give her flowers and see what happens. And he just laughed because I'm like, when's the last time you got your girl flowers?
Yeah.
He's like, dude, it's been years.
Aww.
I'm like, years?
Yeah.
You know, like it's the little things to the feminine that mean the world. And it's just the little thoughtful things because those little thoughtful things or what make her feel seen, mm-hmm. or what make her feel appreciated.
It's not necessarily like these huge, grand, like yeah. It's the things every day that you just notice.
Things. Spin
or
her
compliment.
Around the kitchen, you know, pull her in close, yeah. Kiss her, like do those things and do it with like confidence. And I think that that's really attractive to women is when a man is just like, hey, I see you. And he's, even if he's with you for 5 minutes, or even he just sends you a text message. Hey, I was just thinking of you today. I hope you're having a great day. Because
yeah.
Once again, what is happening? He's pursuing the feminine. Mm-hmm. So he's seeing the feminine. And she feels appreciated. And when that flower feels seen and appreciated, it just stays open and blossoming.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of like if you were to go outside and like pick some flowers and you're like, okay, these flowers are mine now. But then you go and you throw them on the counter. Like they're going to die. Like, yeah, you have them, but they're not going to be open and bloomed. You have to put them in water and then you have to change the water. Like you need to tend to the relationships.
And vice versa too. I mean,
well, that's what I mean.
There's definitely things that the feminine can do for her man as well. And once again, it doesn't always mean it's a man and a woman, the woman being the feminine, the man being the masculine. I mean, this could be same-sex relationships as well. It's just whoever is the masculine core and whoever is the feminine core, it's understanding really how to be loved and how to love each other. And I think for the masculine, one of the ways I like to be loved is really to feel, number one, respected, and number two, my giving is appreciated. You know, because the masculine does really want to give the feminine a beautiful experience. I would say the conscious masculine does. I don't know if all men want that, but I would say a lot of men really do want to give their woman a good experience. And in order to do that, her expression of how she wants to be loved, like what she really desires and how she expresses that to him, mm-hmm. is what makes him a better lover. So, for example, say I walk into the room and I'm very grounded and present and I just have good energy, strong energy in that moment. If you said something to me like, hey, like, I love the way that you just came in here so grounded and present, like that's sexy, you know?
Yeah.
And like, in my mind, in the masculine mind, we work in like check marks, right? Check mark. Did a good job.
Structure.
Yeah. Planning. Clarity, right? I had the vision and the clarity of, okay, I just did something good. I want to do that again. That made her sexually aroused, or that made her smile. That made her happy.
Yeah.
So we learn how to become better lovers through the full expression of what the woman wants. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of women have a lot of shame around their expression, around their sexual energy. So they're not fully open. Their bodies are closed. Their hearts are closed.
Yeah.
And they're not really fully expressing what they want in that relationship. But the thing is, we want to love you deeply. And you can help us to do so by your full expression of that. Once again, I have to be very clear about this too, because both people need to be open and receptive in order for this to work at all. You can't have one person that's closed down, you know, numbed out. Mm-hmm. That's just not working.
Well, if the masculine doesn't feel like they have a purpose in your life, then what's the point of them putting in an effort to it? Like, I mean, there's lots of things that you do for me that I could do for myself, but I don't have to. It doesn't mean that you don't think I can. You know what I mean? I think we're so wrapped up in being powerful, but I feel most powerful when I'm in my feminine energy, or I have them kind of like intertwined. So it's, you have to, I think we judge feminine energy first of all, but we've, like, a lot of people have never really allowed themselves to really indulge in it. We're just judging it because, oh, it's got the word emotions like under the list. So like, oh, that means I'm like crazy, but that's not what it is.
Sensitive.
But that's not what it is, because, yeah. But one thing that you do, which I think is great to share, that's been helpful for me, is like the other day when you're like, I'll move your car. And I'm like, oh, I can do it. And you're like, I would like to give to you in this moment. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, just the reminder, because I wasn't used to that. So those little reminders of, I got you. We're good. I can do it. You know, I would like to do it for you. And then me being on the receiving end, like, okay. You know, like, there has to be space for my feminine energy in your life, and there has to be space for your masculine energy in mine in order to find that balance for each other.
Yeah. And the thing is, if you don't trust masculine energy as a woman, you're not going to receive him. Mm-hmm. If you don't trust masculine energy because you've been hurt by it, because giving has been used against you, or you've been abused by masculine energy, or you've been abandoned by masculine energy, you're really going to struggle to trust masculine energy until you heal those deep masculine wounds. Mm-hmm. So what I see in a lot of the women that I've worked with over the years is their inner masculine is so developed because they're in survival mode, where their feminine energy is just blocked and shut down. And I look at the feminine like water, and that water becomes stagnant in her body, and it's backed up, and she no longer feels that flow moving through her. So even look at how you've changed in our relationship. You went from, I wouldn't say you're super guarded, but pretty guarded in the beginning of our relationship. Even your energy from like pictures and stuff that we've
seen. Oh yeah, it looks different.
So different. You know, your energy is so, so much crazy. More radiant and vibrant as you stepped into your feminine energy. Mm-hmm. As that's happened, you've opened, right? And I've been able to step more into you, which feels good because it's balancing in the relationship, mm-hmm. right? And the reason why masculine core people feel more powerful in that energy is because it's their native energy. Yes, they have feminine energy as well. And the same thing with the woman. If a woman is spending 80, 90% of her day operating in the masculine, but her core is feminine, that's non-native energy. Mm-hmm. She has it. She can do a damn good job with it, but she feels burned out. Her body's tense and rigid and in pain. So as she starts to make that shift, and it is an integration. You spent years doing this work, yeah. You know? Just like I've spent
little
years
little,
stepping
though.
Into my masculine.
Yeah.
So as she moves into that feminine space, that soft, open, receptive space, but really another key here too, because the feminine often gets viewed as like this gentle, soft, flowing thing, and it is. But the feminine is also our inner healer.
Yeah.
It's also the shadow element, the moon energy, right? The darkness that we move into. And that's where we heal. That's where we transform. That's where we change. Most people avoid the feminine because the feminine is scary. It's fucking scary to go into your feminine because it's like, I'm going into my shadows. I'm going into heal, which is the feminine essence. So a lot of men specifically deny that feminine feeling, and they're never fully integrated with their heart because they haven't connected to their emotions. So as the woman navigates into her feminine energy, she really starts to extract this deeper, more profound, juicy, rich life force. It's like this nectar that gets opened, right? It's like when the sap flows through the tree and then it's made into like this beautiful syrup that's sweet. Mm. And it provides you with this nectar. And that's really what happens when you open to your feminine as a feminine core person, as especially like when you're opening to that flow.
Yeah.
It's like opening the river, right? And it's so powerful for that to happen for a woman when she shifts over time and integrates with that feminine essence, it's amazing.
And the power comes from the connection to her body and her intuition, because she doesn't have to overthink things anymore. Because it really is like a no.
It's felt.
Like it's, and it's not a screaming no. Like, I mean, I guess, you know, you go through healing, but I mean, it's not portrayed the same way as the masculine energy is. So it's really just a relaxed, like very sure of the decision. No, I won't do that.
Yeah.
No.
It's normally the first feeling that comes through too for the feminine. Absolutely.
But we bypass that really quickly.
'Cause you judge it.
And go like right up. Yeah. And we're like, no, no, no. Like right away. But the more you get out of here, like I'm pointing to my mind for people that can't see me, and you come down into your body, you'll realize that you're actually like your body and heart and intuition is communicating with you all the time.
Right.
So that's why you can open to masculine energy again, because you know that you're good. Your nervous system is not dependent upon the masculine 24/7. Like, and you can speak from that place of self-confidence and trust, because that's why I think a lot of times people have a hard time opening, or women, feminine energy core people can have a hard time opening to masculine, is because they haven't really felt that power yet. And that trust within themselves. Mm. It's like, you don't regulate me. Like, do you know what I mean?
Right.
Am I clear on it? Yeah.
Yeah. And honestly too, there's a big component of safety here too. So for the feminine to be fully open, they have to feel safe in that energy.
Right.
And a lot of times we use our masculine energy to protect us, but we overdevelop our masculine energy because we don't feel safe at all. I mean, the world we're living in has not really been the prime example of safety.
Right.
There's a lot of fear that's programmed into this matrix way of being. And that's really how we're used to be controlled, mm-hmm. is with the fear, right? So it's easy to manipulate people when you keep them afraid. And the same thing happens right in our body. Like that fear and that vibration of energy gets locked inside of us, and we become so loaded with nervousness and anxiety, and we just feel so overwhelmed, and we just want to crack open and cry. And I tell people, do that.
Do it. I know.
Like, you're feel right. Your just deepest shit. Feel your deepest pain. And that's exactly, you know, what we do at our events. And the event we have coming up in January is something that we're going into, is the healing, the integration, and the embodiment of the masculine and feminine energies. And you get into a room full of a couple hundred people, and you start doing this stuff, and you feel that vibration of the energy, all people going into this, men and women from around the world.
Yeah.
It is so powerful.
Well, you realize you're not the only one who's doing this work, you know, and you feel the support of the community of people who really just want to feel better and want to deepen their intimate life in all facets.
Yeah. I mean, you could sit in your house and meditate all day long, and you can scream and cry into pillows. But when you get into a community of people that really are supporting you and loving you through this process, I mean, it's so powerful.
I hear a lot of people also say, like, I'm trying to find like-minded friends, like-hearted friends. This is a really good place to do that. You know, it's powerful and it's life-changing for sure.
I think something else too I want to talk about is really integrating into deeper union, into deeper commitment.
Yeah.
Because we live in this, as we often talk about, the throwaway culture, mm-hmm. where, you know, you swipe right, swipe left, you got a new girl, new guy next week, and you're just on to the next one.
The grass is always greener kind of thing.
Yes. And that's the thing too, is because we live in this next day shipping mentality, right? It's like,
it's quick.
Yeah.
It's we want quick. It now. We it's want it. We want turnover, it now.
But here's what happens, is people are afraid of that depth. And what I have found in deeper union, when you go and you tread into deeper waters, there is so much freedom found in that. And yes, there's love, which is super attractive to the feminine. Feminine is like, ooh, love. I just want to
feel. You love love too. You stop it.
Yeah, but the masculine desires at the deepest freedom.
Yeah, but
we want to feel free.
But
and
don't
we
you
feel free through our deeper commitments, which is the paradox.
Okay, that's
here.
What I was just going to say. Don't you feel like that actually
love
like
is important
you?
To us?
Yeah.
For men, love is important. We want amazing relationships, and and men that are aware of this find immense value within a good woman. I mean, she can fill you in ways that are just, I can't even describe. Mm-hmm. And I didn't experience that until I got into a relationship with you. I was always super interested in like making a good relationship with a woman, but I just kept failing and failing and failing again. And I was really stuck in this paradigm of just toxic relationships and just kept recycling them.
Yeah.
But what I have found as a man with a mission, this is one of the most important things in my life. And something else that's super important is my relationships. And it's specifically to my intimate relationships. I feared commitment so much. And even up into our relationship for the first year to 2 years, I was still deeply afraid of commitment. But because you had standards that you honored, because you required deeper commitment from me, that was an invitation for me to step up. That doesn't mean I was going to step up.
Right.
But you basically, I remember sitting down with you that one day, and I want to talk about this because this is, you know, a lot of people are like, oh, I want to hear about the commitment thing. Why can't I get any fucking man to commit to me?
But that's a real
yeah.
deep wound. Like, it is. I told you this yesterday too, and we were talking about it, is like there are a lot of women who like can't commit to themselves or can't commit to doing good things for themselves, you know? So like commitment all around is a thing that each and every one of us struggle with.
So the standards and the requirements.
Yes.
And because you were so clear on that, you wanted marriage, you wanted to go deeper into relationship. It scared the hell out of me.
Yeah.
Right. And I'd never thought I would get married or any of this stuff. Right. It was like, nah, just be Peter Pan flying around for the rest of my life.
Oh, goodness.
And I really felt like that, but I always wanted a deeper relationship. I just didn't know if I could ever do it.
I feel like you had said that to me, like at one point where you're like, I'm just a lone wolf. I'm like, yeah. Are you?
Yeah.
Or is that just like, and no offense, but is that just feels a little easier to just like back away?
Well, it is, because it doesn't evoke you to step in.
I think you go, like people go through stages of lone wolf, like you were talking about, kind of isolating yourself, doing some healing work. But the real work of all the work you do on yourself, stay with me here, is to integrate it into your life.
Right. And I felt like because you had those standards and requirement, like, hey, listen, I remember sitting down that one day, I really want a deeper relationship. I really want commitment. I really want to be married. And I was like, okay. You know, I'm like sitting with it. I'm like listening. I'm like, okay.
I smile now, but I was not smiling then.
Yeah. But I was like, well, I need to process this basically. Like, I need to see how this feels. And after sitting with it for quite a while, you know, I came to the realization that like, that's what I wanted too. But it took me so much inner work, inner reflection to get to that point of like, okay, I guess I want that too. And it wasn't even like, I guess it was like, eventually became like, okay, yes.
Yeah,
that's clear to me. And so, because a lot of times like people, when they're in a relationship, they've kept it casual. You know, there's a connection there. Maybe you're playing house at this point and you're living together or you're seeing each other pretty often, but you don't really know where you're going. You don't know really where the relationship is.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times you get the man in the relationship, as the masculine we're saying, takes the lead. And if he's not clear about where he's going, then the woman is sitting back like, okay, what's the deal here?
Mm-hmm.
And if he's like the fly by the seat of my pants type guy, where I don't know where we're going, I don't know how we're getting there, I'm just here for the ride.
Mm-hmm.
That is never going to evoke deep safety. So here's my advice to this. If you're in this type of dynamic right now, number one, be clear about what you want. If you want marriage, if you want to go deeper, especially with this person that you're with, if you feel aligned with them, express that to them. And if they're not willing to give that to you and move into that direction, then that's where you really got to sit with this and ask yourself, is this the type of relationship that I want?
Mm-hmm.
And it's okay to want deeper commitment. Say you want marriage, say you want kids, say you want whatever you want. If you don't express that and you don't honor your true deep yearning to feel claimed, then you'll always regret that.
Right. Well, when we first separated, it had a lot to do with our masculine and feminine dynamics, we realized. And through coming back together, and I felt like I was starting to open more and you were getting more grounded, it moved toward the, okay, everything's actually really great right now. What are we going to do? You know, like, what do we want from here? I suppose is how I want to say it. And it was really, really hard for me to say, I want to be married. I'm not saying you have to do it today, but if that's something you just don't want or you don't see that with me, why would I just skip around and wait on you. You know, it was like, I really wanted clarity on that. And it's hard because I don't know. I suppose we're just like, it's all conditioning, conditioned to believe that you hear guys like, oh, the old ball and chain, oh, marriage, don't do it. You know, like it's never too late to turn back. Like all the people just say these things just because they're used to hearing them, you know, but then women hear, well, don't put too much pressure on him and don't give him an ultimatum. And, but then nobody really fully steps in if we just do what feels like easy.
You're just keeping each other at bay.
Right. And I had to be willing. And even though I didn't want to, like I loved our relationship. Like we were doing great, but I had to be honest with myself and say, I'll be okay if he says no, but I can't, like we have everything going for us like a marriage, but he's still not sure. I don't know if that's the right word to use. I don't want to speak for you.
No, I wasn't certain.
Like you kept saying, I know how I feel about you. I'm just not sure if I can show up.
Yeah, I said, I know I love you. I just don't know how to be with you fully.
That's right.
That was my exact words. And then I remember you saying to me, I deserve to be somebody's full body yes.
Yeah.
And once again, that landed, but it took a while to kind of integrate down into my system.
Well, you have to break away all the ideas that have been like pushed on you.
It had to be clear to me.
Yeah.
It could not be just because it was your desire. It had to be my desire too.
No, and I would not want that. Yeah. I probably said that a ton of times too.
You did.
Like, I don't want you too many to times. Do it.
Because I over-explained yourself.
I did, but I guess just because I wanted you to know. Like, and I'm not saying I wasn't trying to say like you had to be like, yes, in 2 weeks. Like it wasn't really that. It was just I can see this with you. I would like this with you.
It's like you're on a ship together and you're asking me, where is the direction of this boat going?
Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong with asking.
Yeah.
Where is the direction of this boat going? Because if it's not sure, and we're going to continue to go down this path of not sure, and you stayed in this path, and don't get me wrong, it could be not sure for a while, but if he's looking for clarity, if he's looking for clear direction, that's a good sign, right? But if he just keeps with the same excuses of, I don't really know, blah, blah, blah. And he's kind of like dodging it. And he's kind of like the bare minimum type guy to just keep you around and maybe get some booty. You know what I mean? Like, and a lot of men will do that. Mm-hmm. But there are good men. And I want to preface that as well. There are really good men. And I know I've seen good men stepping up because the world is changing. Masculinity is changing. Masculinity is awakening. So is feminine energy. The key here is to be very clear in this moment about what you desire. You know, speaking from a feminine woman to a masculine man, being very clear what you desire from him. If you desire that commitment, you want to know where the ship is going. You're looking for that clarity. And hopefully he wants to provide you with that clarity because clarity creates safety.
Right.
Clarity creates safety, right? His confidence, his certainty. I always teach the three C's to the masculine. Clarity, confidence, certainty. Clarity, confidence, certainty. And if you don't, you're not always going to be clear, confident, and certain. Once again, that 80% mark, if you can hit that 80% of the time, that feels good. She will be so much more receptive and open when you are those things. Once again, she has her work to do. If she has wounds around her masculine energy that she hasn't healed, that she hasn't integrated, she has wounds around her feminine energy that she's not fully expressing herself, she feels shame around her sensuality or sexuality or her emotions, any of this stuff, that's for her to excavate, bring it up, and release it. Same thing with the man, integrating with his heart, getting in mind-heart coherence is what I talk a lot about. It's work. And these things are not like, oh, well, I read this book and it changed my life. Like, no, it doesn't work like that. You actually have to embody the stuff that you hear. You could sit here and listen to podcasts and stuff like this all day long, but if you're not embodying and practicing it in your life, and practicing setting boundaries, and practicing speaking your truth, practicing expressing yourself, practicing being clear with your direction, practicing having confidence, whatever it is that you're looking to be more embodied with, if you're not practicing it, then what's the point of learning everything?
Right.
A lot of people have an overwhelming amount of information, but they're applying zero of it. I said that to one of my friends one time. I said, dude, if you applied 5% of what you knew about all spirituality and relationships, you would be the next freaking enlightened being.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, oh my God, man. Like, you are so wise and you give great advice, but how much of this do you apply to your life? Mm-hmm. Because why is that? We often look outward. We want to change the outer world, but we very often, very rarely look within. Mm-hmm. You know, we blame our partner for what's wrong in our life, but how often are you looking within yourself?
You know, I remember doing a lot of meditation when we were separated. No, really, because I was really doing my best to try to clear out whatever it was that was going on within me once I started to realize, like, I'm really carrying, like, a lot of stuff. And I remember during meditations more than one time, I don't think I ever told you this or anybody, during meditations, I can remember being by water. Like, I would see myself being by water and the sunrise was like yellow and orange, but there was this shadow of a man that was following me everywhere I was walking. And I remember finally being like, what is this? And I'm like, I think it's like matte, like dark, like it looked like a dark outline of like a man. So my perception, I feel like I can see your wheels turning a little bit, but my perception of it was like, there's a darkness around masculine energy like that. It wasn't my shadow, but it was reflected off of me like it was. Does that make sense?
Oh, it was your shadow.
Well, my shadow masculine wounds. Yes, but I remember that. And I'm like, it happened a lot of times because it.
Oh, it was definitely your shadow.
I sat in meditation a lot because I wasn't sure what else to do besides sit there and just like cry it out because I didn't understand it fully because I felt like things were so beautiful between us. And I was allowing myself to just continue to open and open. And I would just cry and I would meditate and I would cry and I would meditate. And then the second time that we took that time apart where it really was a commitment thing where I kept battling with myself. Should I not have said that? No, but I really mean that. Like, I don't want him to marry me or commit to me because I'm threatening him, but I need to stand in my truth and tell him what I want. Like, the worst thing that happens is he says, no, I can't do that for you. Or I can see that you can't. And I remember calling you on the phone. I drove to a parking lot and I like built up my courage and I called you. And again, I said something around the, I can't do this anymore. Like, I think we just need to like let this go because I have to be honest. Like, I really do want marriage and I really do want to create a family dynamic. And I have to let you go if you don't want those things with me or in general. And I remember you didn't say much. I think you were kind of like absorbing it and you're like, okay. And I'm like, all right, I'm going to go now. And I got off the phone and I just like lost it. Cause I was like, I have to let him go to see what is really supposed to happen. Like, I had to hand over everything to like universe and source and, you know, whomever, just to say, I'm going to let it go and like see what happens.
Well, that's a surrendering process. And a lot of people struggle with that because they don't have faith that things are going to work out.
Yeah. And even if they don't, though, they do. Because look at it. We, right in the beginning of the episode, how many times we've left relationships or how, like, so many things now make sense that I was frustrated about in relationships and in just life in general. Like, different places I ended up landing in. Like, it all makes sense. It all had to line up in order for me to fully be me. It's truly an amazing thing, but maybe you don't see it right now, but it's all about coming back to learning and allowing trust.
Well said.
But look at us now, Mr. Woodard.
Yeah.
It really has been, even the tough stuff has really been quite beautiful because it's pulled things out of you and I.
Well, yeah, it's within our quote unquote mistakes or quote unquote failures or quote unquote pain that we experience is where we grow and learn the most. Because there's so much wisdom that comes through our moments of suffering.
Right.
Because we're forced to look within ourselves. We're forced. You can spend all day long distracted, overworking yourself on social media, doing whatever you're doing all day long, living in your head. But when you experience pain, you're going within.
Right.
You know, you go through a heartbreak or you go through something that really hurts you. You want to find answers so that doesn't happen again. pain is such an amazing motivator.
It opens.
And sometimes we need to experience pain a bunch of times. And maybe it's even the same pain. But eventually you say to yourself, enough is enough. I'm done feeling this. I'm done going through this. I'm done recycling these toxic relationships. I'm done settling for these men who are non-committal. I'm done settling for women who are guarded, whatever it is. Like, I just, you have to be honest with yourself. Because at the core of it all, we want to feel love. We want to feel loved. We want to feel seen. We want to feel appreciated. That's what we all want. We all desire that. And something that a conscious relationship, a safe relationship can give you are those things. And it's so beautiful to experience life together with someone that you feel aligned with. And that's really the power of union, because it gives you like that little bit of extra support, that little shot of courage when you're doubting yourself. You know, I'll have times where I'm doubting myself and I'm feeling down about something. And Melissa just, she comes in with just such overwhelming support and love. And she's like, hey, like, I believe in you. And just hearing those words is just that little bit of strength or courage that I needed in that moment. And that's such a beautiful gift of the feminine, is like just that little bit of, hey, I believe that you're going to figure this out. I believe in the direction that you're going. I believe in your decisions. I trust you to figure this out.
Mm-hmm. But I really do.
Yeah, you have to mean it, of course.
I was going
to
say, it's not just like, again, you can say the words. Right. I can say anything to you, but I really do mean it.
It's really super healing and powerful. And there's I really feel like I can get through anything with you by my side. And I think that's so, it's really nourishing to me. It's like you've helped me to soften my rigid masculine edges, because, you know, I grew up in a very violent environment that many people have heard about. And so I had a lot of nervous system trauma responses, I would say. Like, my nervous system was just bloated with anxiety and fear because I was still stuck in survival mode. And sometimes that still shows up. Mm-hmm. And your softness and your gentleness and that just that overall patience is really healing and nourishing. So it's something I really appreciate about you and our relationship.
Well, thank you. That's so sweet. Well, you have really helped me overall bring forth authenticity by seeing me before I fully saw me. And it's the encouragement and the playfulness, which is funny, but in the beginning, like, you were just coming off of healing and I was a little guarded in some ways, and you helped me just be more, it doesn't have to be so serious if that's how I can see it, but you've shown me that there can be structure and flow, and you've created such a safe space for me to be that, so that I can fully be myself and be creative and loving. It works both ways. Mm-hmm. I feel like we can't fully step into the relationship if we don't provide something beautiful for one another. Mm-hmm.
I agree. Well, soul family, we've enjoyed chopping it up with you today, and we are doing a live event this January in Texas, January 21st to the 23rd. This is 3 days of deep. And when I say deep, deep healing work, integration work, embodiment work, there'll be different exercises that we do for boundaries and relationship and masculine and feminine embodiment. Melissa and I are going to be teaching this and leading this. And this environment, you know, a couple hundred people from around the world, men and women, going deep in this space is super healing and super powerful. So whether you're in a relationship right now and you want to go deeper in that relationship, or you're single and you want to manifest a conscious partner, the tools that you're going to be giving are practical and digestible. So you can walk away from this event feeling empowered, feeling clear about what you desire in life. You know, if you resonated with this podcast alone, what we're going to be sharing with you and teaching you at this event will be 100 times this, you know, so it's going to be really deep embodiment work that anchors this down into your body so it lasts. It's not one of these woo-woo pump-up events that you're just going to get excited and leave and go back to the
Foundational all the way up.
Well, we start with the foundation. We start with healing the foundation, going into the inner child wounds, the mother-father template, and all this shit that we carry inside of us, and we excavate it. And Melissa and I are going to be getting down in the trenches with you. You know, it's not like we're just above you or anything like that, because we're not. We're right there with you.
We still are doing, we still do,
every day we practice integration work, and that's what it's all about. So if you want to be a part of this, go ahead and go to jakewoodard.com/awake, and I'll also put the link in the show notes as well, jakewoodard.com/awake. The ticket prices are still at a reduced price right now, and they're going to go up soon, and we really would love to have you there doing this deep work. We love you so much, and we appreciate you. Thank you for taking the time to listen to us and listen to this.
I love sharing this stuff with you. And I love to hear you say, my fiance.
As always, stay open, stay loving, and stay connected to that beautiful source within you.